Chapter 14 is called A New Birth of Freedom, and it's really discussing the American Civil War that was fought, obviously, to eradicate slavery, which we have talked a lot about to this point. Now, each side, the Union and the Confederacy, has some distinct advantages. The Union has all of the advantages in terms of factory production, railroad lines to move what they are producing, a large population to fill the ranks of the army. However, the Confederacy does have a few advantages. It is geographically larger than all of Western Europe, which means this is going to be very easy to fight a defensive campaign. Very similar to the way George Washington fought the Revolution, to fight only when the advantage is yours. Confederate soldiers are also highly motivated. They feel as though they are defending their homes and families. Now, the approach that I mentioned before that compared Washington, if the Confederacy was able to strategically win certain battles, they could actually lose a majority of battles, which they didn't early on, but they could. And if they simply wore down the morale of their opponent, then their opponent would give up. This was Washington's strategy during the Revolution. That was the strategy from the get-go of the Confederacy, but it actually worked out even better for them in the sense that they actually were winning battles early on. Now, the Industrial Revolution, as we discussed in class in the Foner assignment, this transformed warfare big time, and our big advantages to the Union. The Civil War is often referred to as the First Modern War, due to the fact that it was the first major conflict after the Industrial Revolution, and these significant changes included inventions like the mini-ball that you could see came to a bulleted tip and also had grooves in it to go down the grooved rifling of a barrel and make it deadly accurate. When the tactics of this time don't really adjust and they're very outdated, body counts absolutely skyrocket on both sides throughout the war. Production is also a factor. The factory system allows the Union to significantly outproduce the Confederacy, not just in weapons, but textiles to clothe the army, food to feed the army, etc. Now, what is each side's strategy? The Union, and I told you I would include this in the lecture when we discussed it in class. This is a map that actually also appears in the textbook, and it's referred to as Scott's Great Snake. It's actually formally referred to as Scott's Anaconda Plan. If you know anything about anacondas or boa constrictors, they do not strike at their prey to kill them. They actually squeeze their prey to death. The Anaconda Plan said, let's surround the South with a naval blockade, and then let's also secure control of the Mississippi River. So the accuracy of this drawing is not all that great because it shows the snake coming out and around this way, whereas the Mississippi River was going to allow them to control all these northern states and border states, have the naval blockade, and have the control of the Mississippi River, and that would effectively encircle the Confederacy for the snake, shall you say, to choke off their war effort. Now, the Confederacy, in contrast, was run and hide if needed, survive, fight again another day. You would retreat when conditions are unfavorable and execute swift, slashing, Napoleonic-style attacks against your enemy when the conditions are more favorable. And Robert E. Lee absolutely made this strategy his bread and butter. You can see the map here that includes what is often referred to as the Eastern Theater, which is predominantly Virginia. You can see parts of this map that include southern Pennsylvania because of the Battle of Gettysburg, parts of Maryland where there were multiple battles fought, the most famous of which was Antietam. This coloration should include fighting down into the Carolinas and into Georgia, I think, and the separation between the East and the West, in my opinion, should be the western border of Georgia, and including Tennessee and Kentucky and everything in this direction. The reason I think that Georgia should be considered in the Eastern Theater is that Ulysses S. Grant and William Tecumseh Sherman were making a name for themselves out in the Tennessee River Valley and in the Mississippi River Valley. There were really no major battles in Georgia until after Grant takes command of the army, brings Sherman with him, and sends Sherman not only a mission to take Atlanta, but then a mission throughout Georgia to the coast called Sherman's March to the Sea. And because the West had already largely been brought under control by the Union, in my opinion, that means that the fighting in Georgia would be the Eastern Theater, not the Western Theater. But in general, where is the Eastern Theater? Everything along the Atlantic Seaway, and including Georgia. Most battles, an overwhelming majority, are fought in Virginia. And then what is the Western Theater? Well, as I pointed out before, I would draw that line along the western border of Georgia to include Tennessee, Kentucky. Also, there were some battles in Missouri, and that everything west of that line being the Western Theater. Now, early in the war, people thought that the Union was going to be able to end this quickly because of their manpower advantage. However, it didn't work out that way. The very first troops marched out of Washington, D.C. and tried to make a move on Manassas Junction. It was a railroad junction. This is strategic. If you take away the very little railroad line access that the Confederacy has in comparison, and I will go back to the railroad mileage map. This is often included in the Regents exam and asking you to identify. So let's draw a line on this map, in fact, that shows both Confederate states, but also then border states and northern states. So the separation between Missouri, Kentucky remained loyal. Western Virginia remained loyal, and Maryland and Delaware remained loyal. So that really, that line. Everything below this, you can see there is some rail lines, but there's just such an overwhelming amount in the north that it's a big advantage for the Union, especially if Manassas had worked out for them. The Battle of Bull Run, as it's known to the north. This would have been a crippling blow against the Confederacy. However, Robert E. Lee and one of his best battlefield commanders, Stonewall Jackson, manages to not only win the Battle of Bull Run, but win a series of battles early on. And the reason being that a lot of the best military leaders are Southerners. Lee's battle tactics are actually still studied by officers at our major military academies to this day. Meanwhile, timid Union commanders like George McClellan fumbled their duties badly. They had superior numbers, superior supplies, and they were just too timid to go and get Robert E. Lee's army and crush them. Probably could have had you had a little more aggressive commander. What's done is done. It wasn't done that way. And the first 2 years of the war, from 1861 to right through the spring of 1863, so about 2 year period, you have almost all Confederate victories. This slashing blow and live to fight again another day strategy is working out rather well for the Confederacy. You can see here a series of battles, not just Manassas. After Manassas was a failure, the army retreated back to Washington, and there was another strategic attempt at what was known as the Peninsula Campaign, part of which was the 7 Days Battle. So you can see the Peninsula Campaign moved up this way, and the 7 Days Battle was a series of battles fought over 7 days, of course. And the move here was, let's move directly on Richmond. It didn't work out. The Union was defeated again and had to retreat. Then, later, you have the Union and its superior navy fight its way up into the headwaters of the Rappahannock River and bringing their army near a town called Fredericksburg. And they get to Fredericksburg, and they should have moved more quickly. They didn't. The Confederates got into much better position on high ground behind a stone wall. And by this time, George McClellan, that timid commander I mentioned before, had been fired in favor of Ambrose Burnside. Burnside is much more aggressive, but not nearly as textbook smart as McClellan was. So he's the polar opposite. McClellan was very smart. He knew how to train and supply an army, but he just wasn't aggressive on the battlefield. Burnside's the opposite. He doesn't know all that textbook stuff, and he's over-aggressive. Fredericksburg is an absolute slaughter, and the Union loses. Now, excuse me. When Burnside is immediately fired after bungling the battle at Fredericksburg, he is relieved and replaced by a man named Joe Hooker. Hooker is viewed as the perfect balance between the two. He is much more aggressive than McClellan, but not a complete idiot like Burnside had been at Fredericksburg. Unfortunately, Hooker has assembled his army near Chancellorsville, Virginia, and when Lee discusses this with Stonewall Jackson, they make this daring plan to move a large chunk of their army from Fredericksburg over to Chancellorsville and attack Hooker in a surprise attack in which he got quickly surrounded and resoundingly defeated. So here you are, if you notice, end of April, beginning of May, 1863, and the Union is being utterly embarrassed repeatedly. Now, what's going on in the grand scheme of things? I'm going to go back to this map of the Eastern and Western Theater, and I've cleared the annotations here. So a lot of defeats are going on for the Union here in the Eastern Theater. And what's going on in the West, though? The West is being absolutely dominated by General Grant, among others. They've won a series of battles in the Tennessee River Valley. They've won a series of battles in the Mississippi River Valley, and one of the only remaining places left to defeat is a place called Vicksburg on the Mississippi River. And Grant has laid siege to Vicksburg. He has surrounded it, and laying siege to it just means that you're cutting off their supplies. You are not doing a full-scale attack, but you are constantly using artillery barrages to demoralize the enemy. They can't get resupplied. And why am I mentioning this? Well, because after this success in the east that includes this late April, early May victory at Chancellorsville, Lee says, I need to draw attention away from the Western Theater. I need resources to have to be diverted away from the Western Theater and back toward me so we don't lose Vicksburg. If we do, that Anaconda plan is going to come into play and we are going to lose. So, Lee sneaks his army through the Blue Ridge Mountains in Western Virginia and West Virginia that has now freed itself from Virginia over the issue of slavery, and he invades the North, and he eventually makes his way to Gettysburg. Now, if you ever look at a map of Gettysburg, there's a reason for this, that the armies end up at Gettysburg. So if this blank slide is a giant map of the border between Maryland, which would be down here, and Pennsylvania here. Here's the border, as I said before, Lee, and I'll switch over to red as the movements of the Confederate Army. And if Gettysburg just is inside of the Pennsylvania border here, if you ever look at a map, all of the roads back then spiderwebbed almost like a wagon wheel into Gettysburg from every which direction. So when, and this is an exaggeration, I don't even think there was that many particular roads, but as I mentioned before, I'll use red. So as Lee's army is moving, and he actually goes further north than Gettysburg and swings back around, okay? And it makes sense that he will end up in Gettysburg when he has moved that far north based on the road network. Likewise, it also makes sense that as the Union is shadowing his movements and keeping track of him, that they will find their way to Gettysburg. And so it makes sense that the Battle of Gettysburg ends up being fought where it is. Now, I'm going to back up a moment. I just did a verbal summary of all this, but now some brief note-taking on all these things. As morale in the Union war effort plummeted in those first couple of years, the Battle of Antietam is fought in September of 1862, and despite the fact that it was tactically a tie, Lee withdraws and moves back into the South. Lincoln uses this as a victory, or so he claims, and issues an announcement that he will be making a statement on emancipation in the new year. The written formal version of it was to come out on the 1st of January the following year. So because morale is so low, Lincoln knows he needs a morale boost. So that's really why emancipation was issued. At the beginning of the war, had the Confederate States been willing to come back into the Union, Lincoln made it perfectly clear that he was more than willing to allow them to keep their slaves. But obviously, with how badly the war effort was going, he needed emancipation for that morale boost. So he shifted from a preserve the Union mentality to an emancipation mentality. As I mentioned before, Grant makes a name for himself in the Tennessee and Mississippi River valleys. So you can see that Admiral Farragut of the Union Navy took control of Mobile, Alabama, New Orleans, Baton Rouge, and at the same time, Fort Henry and Fort Donelson are being captured by Grant, and from there, you just have these two different sides trying to converge, and Vicksburg is right here. So that is going very, very well for Grant and the Union war effort in the West. Hence, over here in the East, where there's lots of Union defeats, in order to distract from all that success in the West, Lee mounts his invasion of the North. What impact do black troops have on the Civil War? Well, probably the most beautiful microcosm of that, depicted in two different paintings here. This one, a much simpler lithograph. This one, a beautiful painting of the ranks of the 54th Massachusetts, with Colonel Robert Gould Shaw depicted here. He is played by Matthew Broderick in the Hollywood film Glory. His sergeant major, a black man, highest ranking black man to ever serve in the military up to that point. And actually, it was illegal that he appointed him to be a sergeant major, but he did it anyway, kind of as a flip the bird to the racist command of the Union Army. And that sergeant major is depicted by Morgan Freeman in the film. Amazing, amazing story. The movie depicts what is in this lithograph, which is the epic Battle of Fort Wagner, where the 54th Massachusetts fought very valiantly in battle. And towards the tail end of the war, Abraham Lincoln himself issues statements crediting the influx of black troops and that increased manpower with helping turn the tide of the war. So, the turning points, okay? I verbally described it. I drew the map of Gettysburg for you, saw the reasons out in the Western theater why you would have a invasion of the North, and you can see the zoomed in version of it here, okay? Now, what is the dotted? Okay, this is tactically speaking at the Battle of Gettysburg, one of the biggest reasons why Gettysburg is an epic failure for the Confederacy. It is entirely possible for the Confederacy to win this battle. And the cavalry under Jeb Stuart leaves Lee in the mountains, the Blue Ridge Mountains, and he actually takes a different path. If you follow along here, you see that his path, and I'll use yellow for Stuart, that he ends up taking this path to end up at Gettysburg, and he actually arrives late on the battlefield. With Stuart's late arrival at Gettysburg, Lee is not only denied cavalry to use in battle, but he, leading up to Gettysburg, is denied the eyes and ears of his war effort because cavalry troops are not only used in battle, they are used to surveil the enemy and report back to the commander on what the enemy's doing. And because of that big failure, Gettysburg ended up being a big mess for the Confederacy and was instead a resounding Union victory. So, ironically enough, what is meant to be a slashing blow against the Union in favor of the Confederacy, it ends up being a resounding Union victory instead. Even on the final day of Gettysburg and Pickett's Charge, people often ask the question, why would Lee, having done such a beautiful job of commanding the Confederate war effort throughout the war, why would he even made such a silly decision? And again, it probably goes back to the pressure he was under to strike that big blow against the Union. So he's under a lot of pressure to win and to win big. Besides that, there are some accounts, not exactly false per se, but unfounded too, like hard to prove, that Lee was battling a bout of dysentery. So he had horrible diarrhea and was probably not feeling all that well. And so some people think he wasn't exactly in his right mind either. But that's not exactly a hard evidence historical narrative either. In the same exact weekend as the victory at Gettysburg, The siege at Vicksburg ends with the surrender of the fort to Union troops. So the winning of Vicksburg is the final link in Scott's Anaconda plan. So after these two victories, now the remainder of the war is really going to be about finishing off the Confederacy. In November of 1863, Lincoln travels to Gettysburg to give a brief speech, as the cemetery that is being dedicated to the soldiers who fought there is having its ribbon cutting. And it's really just kind of a one of those silly little presidential visits. We even have them today in the modern world. Presidents will regularly visit the ribbon cutting of a new major bridge or something in a major city, or they will appear at a factory with workers, and they may give a brief talk. And this, in 1863, is what Lincoln really views his Gettysburg address as. He more or less scribbles out his speech on some paper on the train on the way to Gettysburg. He did not view this as a huge deal, or he probably would have spent countless hours crafting it in advance. But ironically enough, this goes down as probably one of the greatest speeches ever given, not just in American history, but ever. And what's even funnier about this is that the keynote speaker is a very famous orator. He's actually a preacher and a former Massachusetts governor, and his name is Edward Everett. He's depicted in the painting directly behind Abraham Lincoln here. And he spoke for over 2 hours. And then Lincoln, after Everett is done, only speaks for a couple of minutes. And there's a famous quote, something to the effect of Edwin Everett saying that Lincoln had said far more than he had in 2 hours and only 2 minutes. I'm going to have you listen to this speech immediately following this slide as it's read by Johnny Cash, who is like not only one of my favorite musical artists, but just has that kind of distinctive voice that hearing something like the Gettysburg Address from his voice is pretty epic. So lastly, before I get to that, you hear me over and over saying, KISS, keep it simple, stupid. Don't overdo it, because if you overdo it, that's when you can screw up. Well, the Gettysburg Address is hands down the textbook case of keep it simple, stupid. So listen to the Gettysburg Address, and then we'll finish up the lecture.
67 years ago, so began the message of a war-weary President Abraham Lincoln. A message written on the back of an envelope on the train on the way to dedicate a battlefield where men from the North and South had died at Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. 67 years ago, our forefathers brought forth on this continent a new nation conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now, we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. For the brave men living and dead who struggled here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, and that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
In 1864, Sherman and Grant come east from the Western Theater to take over the Eastern Theater war effort. In July of 1864, you have the burning of Atlanta, and then immediately following is Sherman's March to the Sea, and you can kind of relate this to the presidential campaign of 1864. Lincoln was actually quite nervous that he would lose. His opponent, George McClellan, was the Union commander that he had fired after the beginning of the war was so horribly bungled. And McClellan, his campaign is essentially that Lincoln's mishandling the war, I can do this so much better, I will end the war. What he's not telling the people is he actually had, like, peace plans, not go and defeat the Confederacy plans, but peace plans to bring the war to an end, probably with an independent Confederate States of America. So why is this total war strategy of the burning of Atlanta and the march to the sea and the burning of all the crops in his path? This is because Lincoln says, we need to make it perfectly obvious that we are going to win this war by the time the election rolls around, or I'm in serious trouble of losing, and therefore the Union is in very serious trouble of losing the whole war. So you have in July of 1864 the burning of Atlanta, and then in a letter to the city of Atlanta, the leadership of the city of Atlanta, Sherman in September 1864 is quoted as having written, "War is cruelty. There is no use trying to reform it. The crueler it is, the sooner it will be over." And this really is the total war strategy in a nutshell. That yes, it's awful, we don't exactly feel good about doing this, but if this is what it's going to take to win, then we will do it, and it is probably better in the long run anyway. That the amount of civilian suffering and the amount of military casualties will likely, on a whole, be less than if we didn't do this. The very same mentality is used in World War II when heavy bombing of Germany during the war. Civilians suffered dearly during those bombing raids, but we did it as a total war strategy. We need to end this sooner rather than later. Likewise, when President Harry Truman drops the atomic bomb on Japan, which is controversial to this day, one of his biggest reasons for doing so was he feared some of the military estimates that had been given to him were of upwards of 1 million American casualties in a land invasion of Japan. And he weighed the difference between doing that and dropping this bomb. And despite the fact that the bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima and the second that was dropped on Nagasaki, despite the fact that that did obviously horrific civilian damage, innocent people were irradiated in those attacks, he did so thinking that the horror of dropping those, that they didn't even fully understand, honestly, there were U.S. Military commanders and President Truman himself that were a little bit in awe of their own weapon after it was used. And anyway, they thought that that was the better option. As horrible as it was the better option. So with those total war strategies being used for the remainder of the war, the Union does win. Lee surrenders at Appomattox, and it's pretty gracious, honestly. At Appomattox, Grant sits down with Lee and essentially says, if your men sign a parole, which means, like, hey, I will never take up arms against the United States ever again, they can go home. They can even take their own weapons with them if it's their own personal weapon. And if it was issued to them, have them stack it up before they leave. That's really about as simple as the terms were. Lee was pleasantly surprised because in human history, oftentimes when you defeat an enemy, especially after a war as costly and as deadly as the Civil War, you're looking to hang people in the streets and make an example of them. And so Lee was very pleasantly surprised when he signed the surrender at what the terms were. And the reason was because Lincoln had met with Grant and Sherman and said, listen, total war, no holds barred, but the minute they give up, we are going to bring them back into the nation again, and it must be a conciliatory peace. It cannot be a punishing peace. And he speaks to exactly that in his inaugural address on March 4th of 1865. You can see him down here speaking, and up here is none other than John Wilkes Booth, watching him speak. On April 4th of 1865 is when Richmond fell, and it was not long after that Lee surrendered to Grant. Unfortunately, Lincoln's generous peace plan was killed with him. Any hope of this fair and generous peace is lost. The moment that John Wilkes Booth points that pistol at the back of Abraham Lincoln's head and pulls the trigger, the punishing, nasty, divisive Reconstruction policies brought on by the radical Republicans in Congress turned this from what was probably a fair and generous peace under Lincoln to a harsh and punishing one under the radical Republicans that wanted vengeance on behalf of Lincoln. This is the end of the lecture. If you have any questions, by all means, reach out to me. Otherwise, I will see you in class.